The green crystal can be analyzed for its oxalate content. This is done using a titration. The titration that you're going to be using is shown on your screen. This titration follows the same steps as the sodium hydroxide and KHP titration, but is a little bit more complicated. The potassium permanganate solution needs to be standardized. Around 0.2 grams of sodium oxalate is used to standardize this solution. When dissolving the solid, it is important to first add the water and then the sulfuric acid for safety reasons. Sulfuric acid is a concentrated and strong acid, and you must be wearing gloves at all times when handling. Before starting the titration, the solution must be heated to 85 degrees Celsius in a fume hood. When moving that hot solution from the fume hood to your titration setup, you must use a pair of hot gloves. After recording the initial volume, the titrant is added until the endpoint is reached. If the solution drops below 60 degrees during the titration, it should be reheated. After recording the final volume, the concentration of permanganate can be calculated. This should be done right away so you can share the value with your group. Plug in your values to this example calculation to quickly determine your permanganate concentration. Make sure to share this value with your group members afterwards. Now the same type of titration is repeated, but you'll be using your green crystals instead of sodium oxalate. This titration of the green crystals will allow you to determine the percent oxalate in that sample.
Instead of a normal lab report for this experiment, you'll complete a green crystal summary report, which incorporates data from the past three experiments. Let's start by reviewing the calculations for the oxalate titration. The potassium permanganate concentration is calculated by taking the mass of the sodium oxalate standard, dividing it by its molar mass, multiplying by the molar ratio between permanganate and oxalate, and finally dividing by the volume of permanganate used, plus a unit conversion to get units of molarity. This is the calculation you should perform in class so you can share your value with your group members. You should then average your value and their values to obtain an average permanganate concentration. After you've titrated your green crystal sample, you can calculate the mass of oxalate. This is done by taking the volume of permanganate used plus a unit conversion and multiplying it by the concentration, then the molar ratio between oxalate and permanganate, and then multiplying it by the molar mass of oxalate. The percent oxalate can now be calculated by comparing this mass against the mass of the green crystals that were titrated. There are a few other calculations you need to perform for the summary report. One is finding the theoretical weight percent. This can be done for any atom or groups of atoms in a molecule. For example, to calculate the percent weight of calcium in calcium phosphate, we'll simply take the molar mass of calcium, 40.08, and multiply it by 3, since there are 3 calciums in this molecule, and divide that by the molar mass of the whole compound, which is 310.18, and multiply by 100. This gives us a theoretical percent calcium of 38.76. It's up to you to do a similar calculation for iron and oxalate in the green crystals. Just keep in mind the full formula of the green crystals, including those 3 water molecules. The weight percent of an atom or group of atoms in a molecule can also be used to find the moles in a certain mass of that molecule. If we have 100 grams of calcium phosphate, and we know that 38.76% of that mass is calcium, then we have 38.76 grams of calcium. Dividing that by the molar mass gives us the number of moles of calcium. Once you've completed these calculations for the iron and oxalate in your green crystals, you should be able to complete the summary report. Be sure to follow the outline on Moodle and include all the information it asks for.